Counter, professor of neurology and neuroscience here at Harvard Medical School and director of the Harvard Foundation. And it is the Harvard Foundation and its students and faculty that have come together as a group to present this special program. What a great honor it is for us to bring you this program today. We have a very special guest of honor. We have a distinguished Nobel Prize laureate. I must say that it was my honor to meet Dr. Takaaki Kajita at last year's Nobel Prize ceremony in Stockholm. He received me very graciously as we discussed the possibility of his visiting our students and faculty here at Harvard. He was kind enough to say that he'd be honored to do that. Each year, we nominate people to our student faculty committee to be selected as Scientists of the Year. We also nominate persons as Artist of the Year. We also nominate individuals as Humanitarian of the Year. As you know, we've had such guests here for our students and people who meet with and engage our students as Ban Ki-moon. We've had a number of distinguished guests, most recently Aung San Suu Kyi, and distinguished individuals from all over the world who bring a special message to our students. In the science area, our most recent honorees have included Dr. Lisa Goodman, who's an astronomer, professor of astrophysics. In this very department, Dr. Lisa Randall, distinguished theoretical physicist and author. And we've had Jim Gates, the president's medalist in science, among others. Today, it is my honor to say to you that the students and faculty of the Harvard Foundation ask that we honor, through the university, its officials, its deans, Dr. Takaaki Kajita as our 2016 Scientist of the Year. So I'd like to ask Dr. Kajita to come forward. So we can present this special award to you. It is the Harvard Foundation Award, and it says Harvard University, the Harvard Foundation presents the Scientist of the Year Award to Dr. Takaaki Kajita, professor and director of the Institute for Cosmic Ray Research, University of Tokyo, 2015 Physics Nobel Prize laureate, to honor his outstanding contributions to physics, science education, and his inspiration for scholars of all backgrounds in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Given in Cambridge, Massachusetts, in the year 2016, and of Harvard College, the 380th year. Thank you very much, sir, for your great contribution.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And now it's my privilege to welcome to the podium the host for this program, who has been most kind and gracious to us throughout the process, and it's been a privilege to work with him, and that's Dr. Masahiro Mori, who is the professor of physics and chair of the Department of Physics here at Harvard. Dr. Mori.
Thank you. Okay, do I actually need a microphone? Maybe? Well, it seemed to be working. Okay, let's go with that. So it is my honor and privilege and pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Professor Takaaki Kajita of University of Tokyo. Unfortunately, Alan has said everything about his honors and listed them all, so there's very few things I can add to that, but let me just go back a little bit. So Professor Kajita has received his PhD from University of Tokyo in 1986, studying under Masatoshi Koshiba, who, by the way, has won Nobel Prize in Physics in 2002, so 14 years earlier than he did. And later, working under Yoji Totsuka, he worked on experiments, two experiments actually. Initially, an experiment called Kamiokande, and then later, starting 1996, the bigger version of Kamiokande, which they apparently ran out of names and they called it Super Kamiokande. And it was this Super Kamiokande where he was the lead physicist in analyzing data and came up with this discovery of neutrino oscillation around 1998 in announced, and that later led to his Nobel Prize in 2015. The I happen to be an experimental particle physicist myself, and the neutrinos are really, really interesting things. Particle physicists always talk about the standard model, the kind of theoretical framework that allows us to explain the behavior of almost all the particles we have discovered so far. And neutrinos actually occupy sort of kind of a slightly darkish corner of that theory where things are slightly murkier. They interact so weakly so that actually literally trillions of them are going past your body every second and nothing pretty much happens. It's, you know, kind of transparent. They're so light that we actually don't know how light they are, but indications, including the ones that are produced by super Kamiokande experiments, suggest that neutrinos are lighter than hydrogen atom by about 10 billion times, somewhere there, 10 orders of magnitude, incredibly light stuff. And it's a little bit of a surprise that we even know that it's not zero. And in fact, in the standard model of particle physics, neutrino is by hand assigned zero mass. They are not supposed to have a mass. And this existence of neutrino mass is one really clear empirical evidence, something that came out of experiment that we have that tells you that the standard model of particle physics is incomplete. And Dr. Kajita's experiment called Super Kamiokande studied this by basically comparing the number of neutrinos coming to you down from the sky against the number that coming to you from below your feet, or from below your feet, there is nothing. But as I said, neutrinos can penetrate everything and you can actually see them passing all the way through the Earth. And you count them and you compare them. And what do you learn from that? Well, I'm not going to spoil a good story for you, right? So let's welcome Professor Kajita.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, good afternoon. Well, it's my pleasure and honor to speak here. And also, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Now, so today I'd like to discuss the discovery of atmospheric neutrino oscillations. The outline of this talk is something like that. Yes, I have a brief introduction on neutrinos and also on atmospheric neutrinos. Then I want to discuss the old days, that is the atmospheric Neumann deficit in the 80s and discovery of neutrino oscillations. Then, well, in the remaining time, I want to briefly discuss the oscillation studies with atmospheric neutrinos, more recent studies, and also I want to briefly mention about the future neutrino oscillation experiments. And I'll summarize. Okay, well, introduction. Well, already Maurice presented the introduction of this part. Anyway, let me repeat. Well, now I want to tell you about what, well, I want to tell you what are neutrinos. Well, neutrinos are elementary particles like electrons and quarks, and they have no electric charge. And neutrinos have, like other particles, three types or three flavors: electron neutrinos, muon neutrinos, and tau neutrinos. And I want to say that neutrinos are actually produced in various places, such as the Earth's atmosphere. And they can easily penetrate through everything, say, through the Earth, as I wrote in the right. And well, however, it's important they interact extremely rarely, but they interact. Therefore, we can study neutrinos by observing real neutrino interactions. And also, it's important that muon neutrino interaction produce a muon, and an electron neutrino interaction produce an electron. We know this relation. Therefore, by observing, for example, a muon by a neutrino interaction, we know that a muon neutrino come to the detector. And finally, as Mori sensei told us, that in the very successful standard model of particle physics, neutrinos are assumed to have no mass. But of course, physicists, we have been studying if neutrinos have really no mass. Okay, now, we have been observing atmospheric neutrinos. So therefore, I want to briefly discuss what are atmospheric neutrinos. As you may know, there are cosmic ray particles entering into the Earth from somewhere. And these particles come into the atmosphere from various directions. And therefore, these neutrinos come into the, say, whole atmosphere in the Earth. And these cosmic rays, once enter into the atmosphere, they interact with the air nucleus. And in these interactions, typically, pions are produced. But pions are unstable. Therefore, pions soon decay to muons. And also, muons are unstable. Therefore, they decay to electrons. And during this decay chain, two muon neutrinos and one electron neutrino are produced. And they are observed in underground detectors. And well, the study of these neutrinos led to the discovery of neutrino oscillations. Therefore, well, I want to tell you what were the important feature in the discovery. First, because of this production mechanism of neutrinos, that is two muon neutrinos plus one electron neutrinos are produced from the one pion decay, we understand that the muon neutrino to electron neutrino ratio quite well. In addition, since the cosmic ray particles come into the atmosphere, well, essentially isotropically and coming into the whole atmosphere, therefore, the up-down flux ratio of these neutrinos are well understood and actually essentially equal to one. And finally, of course, neutrinos produced in the other side of the Earth have to travel long distances before coming to the detector. So these three features were very important for the discovery of neutrino oscillations. Now, I want to briefly discuss the history of atmospheric neutrino studies. In fact, the initial experiment that observed atmospheric neutrinos were carried out more than 50 years ago. There were two experiments that observed atmospheric neutrinos for the first time. One was carried out in South Africa, another one in India. Both of these experiments were carried out in an extremely deep underground. The South Africa experiment was carried out at 3.2 kilometers below the surface, which is much, much, much deeper than the present-day experiments. And the Indian experiment was also carried out at the 2.4 kilometer depth. Anyway, these two experiments observed atmospheric neutrinos for the first time in 1965. Well, I want to show you one result from these experiments. Well, this is a little bit too technical. Anyway, since the, electronics 50 years ago was not so advanced, these experiments only measure the muon direction. If a muon comes from the top, the vertically going down, then they only travel 3.2 kilometers. Therefore, sometimes cosmic ray muons produced in the atmosphere can come down to the 3 kilometer underground detector. But if a muon comes from the near horizon, they cannot be due to cosmic ray muons. They must be produced by other ways. That is due to the neutrino interactions. So that way, they observed the evidence for evidence for atmospheric neutrinos. By the way, this is actually a 1978 paper, and well, if we carefully read their paper, they wrote at the conclusion, we conclude that there is a fair agreement between the total observed and expected neutrino-induced muon flux, namely, flux predicted over flux observed is 1.6 plus minus 0.4. The uncertainty arises from the neutrino flux plus minus, say, 30%. Well, okay. So they conclude that there is a fair agreement between data and the prediction. But if we carefully read, there is a deficit of neutrino events recorded. Anyway, the interest in the cosmic ray atmospheric neutrino studies was kind of a minor topic, and many people lost, probably, well, I'm not sure, before I started the studies, so I don't know exactly, but I believe many people's interest in this kind of study was not very high. But in the 80s, there were other types of underground experiments that were proton decay experiments. Well, in the 70s, there were new theories called grand unified theories that unify the strong, weak, and electromagnetic forces of elementary particles. And these theories predicted that the proton lifetime should be around 10 to 30 years. Of course, 10 to 30 years is a long lifetime, but this suggests if we observe 10 to 30 protons in 1 year, we may observe one proton decay. Therefore, several large underground experiments started in the 80s. Here I show five experiments: Kamiokande, IMB, KGF, New Sex, Reduce. And these experiments observed many contained atmospheric neutrino events. They are the background for proton decay. So these proton decay experiments trying to observe proton decay, but actually they observed many contained atmospheric neutrino events. Now, because I was involved in the Kamiokande experiment, I want to discuss a little bit what we did in the 80s. Well, first I want to show you our Kamiokande team. This photo was taken in spring of 1983 when we constructed the Kamiokande experiment in Kamioka, Japan. Actually, this experiment was constructed in an active mine. And therefore, well, going into the mine, we have to wear a safety hat and rubber boots and so on. So this was the way we go into the mine. And in fact, I think we needed the safety hat and the rubber boots. Well, this photo is a little bit older. I don't exactly remember it was 80, well, the autumn of 81 or the winter, early winter of, well, winter of 82. But anyway, this was the photo we took when we first test phototubes, electronics, and so on at the site. This was actually before the excavation started. So we came to the site of the Kamiokande experiment and checked various things, and you can see the environment is not very clean. So this is the way we had to work. Anyway, well, this is outside of the Kamiokande tank. Inside is a little bit better. Okay, this is the photo we took when we constructed the Kamiokande detector. In fact, we had to install 1,000 photomultiplier tubes into the detector wall. And actually, this tank is a, say, 3 kiloton water tank with the diameter of 60 meters and the height of 60 meters. Therefore, it was not trivial to install these photomultiplier tubes at the 60-meter high. And therefore, the decision we made was to use rubber boards. Unfortunately, rubber boards had a not very stable floor. Therefore, our working condition was not so good. But, well, I think it was better to fall off from the 60-meter high. So I think this was a good solution. Anyway, this experiment searched for proton decays, but unfortunately, these experiments didn't observe proton decays. So, but because atmospheric neutrinos are the most serious background to the proton decay searches, it was necessary to understand atmospheric neutrino interactions or backgrounds. Then it was noted that the fraction of muon decay signal in an event was smaller than expected. Well, this was noted by both IMB experiment and the Kamiokande experiment. And now we understand this discrepancy was due to neutrino oscillations. But at the time, we didn't know what happened. Now, from now on, maybe this page, in this page, I just want to mention what I did when I was young. Well, I got my PhD in March 1986. And well, my thesis topic was on the search for proton decays. And of course, I didn't find any proton decays. But I noticed while I was writing paper, I noticed that we could still improve the analysis. But well, at least in the University of Tokyo, we have a thesis submission deadline. Therefore, I didn't have time to improve the software while I was writing my thesis. But as soon as I submitted my thesis, I started to improve the software. And in fact, I did several things. And one of them was the software to identify the particle type for Cherenkov ring. Well, in the right, I show two patterns of Cherenkov lights observed in Kamiokande experiment. The right top one is the typical electron event produced by electron neutrino interaction. The lower one is the muon event, a typical muon event produced by muon neutrino interaction. So I wanted to identify if an event was produced by an electron or a muon. This is important to search for proton, to the search for proton decays. But anyway, well, if we develop a new software, we have to check if the software works properly. So we did various checks, and one of them was a test with the existing neutrino data observed in Kamiokande. So I applied the software to the Kamiokande data. Then immediately I noticed that the number of muon neutrino event was much fewer than expected. So this clearly suggested that my software must be wrong. But well, soon after, I found that the software may not be the cause of this problem. We may have some other problem somewhere in the, say, for example, in the data reduction, simulation, somewhere. Anyway, because of this problem, we thought that we need to find the cause of the problem. Because, well, if we have any serious problem in the experiment, then all the analysis we are doing has essentially meaning nothing. So we really had to find the mistake in the data analysis. So after this, we worked very hard for about 1 year, but we didn't find any mistake. So, well, after 1 year, we thought that we did everything. So we decided to write a paper reporting the deficit of muon neutrino events. So we wrote a paper and published in 1988. And the, well, essential data we showed in this paper is just copied here, this single table. we showed the number of observed muon neutrino events compared with the predicted number of muon neutrino events. And also, we showed the number of observed electron neutrino events and compared with the prediction. And you can see, for electron neutrinos, the data and the prediction agree reasonably well. But you, at the same time, you can clearly see a significant deficit of muon neutrino events. So, well, we concluded that some as unaccounted for physics, such as neutrino oscillations, might explain the data. That was the conclusion of the paper. Well, of course, we noted that neutrino oscillation could be the solution, but well, that was just a possibility. We are at this stage, we are unable to prove that neutrino oscillation was the solution. Anyway, I want to mention that I was most excited with the possibility of neutrino oscillations with large mixing angle. That means neutrinos seems to be oscillating to other neutrino type maximally. That was a kind of excitement to me. And therefore, essentially, I decided to concentrate on this study. And yeah, in fact, this, maximum oscillation was my motivation to continue the study on this problem. Now, we published the result, and several years later, another large water Cherenkov experiment, IMB, reported the similar result. And they also showed the deficit of muon neutrino events. So at that stage, two experiments showed the similar results. Therefore, maybe it, at that time, we were in a stage to think about the possible physics involved. And well, but although it was clear that the small mu over E ratio implied something unexpected, the physics behind the result was unknown. Of course, we recognized that neutrino oscillations was a possibility, but there were several possibilities. Was the result due to neutrino oscillations? And if so, oscillation is between muon neutrino and electron neutrino, or muon neutrino and tau neutrino, or some other physics. So we wanted to know what are the physics involved. And if it is due to neutrino oscillations, then, for example, muon neutrinos produced at, point zero may travel, and while they're traveling, the probability that nu mu to remain nu mu gets small, but if they travel further, the probability come back to unity. That means muon neutrino is muon neutrino. If they travel further, the probability goes down. So this kind of oscillation, oscillative behavior is called neutrino oscillations. Now, we really wanted to know what are the sources, what are the cause of this muon neutrino deficit. And we really wanted to know if the deficit was due to neutrino oscillations. Therefore, we thought another measurement, that is the directional measurement of neutrino events. a neutrino is produced in the upper atmosphere, and if they are detected in super Kamiokande, they can only travel 10 to 20 kilometers. So the neutrinos can travel only a short distances. But if a neutrino is produced in the other side of the Earth, they can travel typically 10,000 kilometers. So they travel really long distances. Therefore, they may have enough time to oscillate. So maybe we should observe the deficit of upward-going muon neutrino events. In fact, the importance of this measurement was already noted in the Kamiokande era, and we studied the Kamiokande data carefully for several years. And this was the publication of the Kamiokande data in 94. And, well, the graph shows the neutrino arrival direction distribution. Cosine theta, cosine zenith 1 means downgoing neutrinos, minus 1 means upward going neutrinos. And the data suggests that there is a deficit of upward going neutrinos. But you also notice that the statistical error is large. Therefore, unfortunately, statistical significance was not so good. Therefore, we were unable to conclude. And, well, it was clear that we needed a much larger detector than Kamiokande, and that is super Kamiokande. Now, I want to move on to the discovery of oscillations. Yes, super Kamiokande is in fact a much larger detector, much larger version of the Kamiokande detector. It is a 40 meter diameter, 40 meter in height, and the total volume is 50 kilotons. And basically the total size is about 20 times larger than the Kamiokande detector. And it is an international collaboration of scientists from 8 countries, and we have about 140 collaborators now. The construction of the Super Kamiokande started in 1991, and already in 1992, we had a serious discussion on the collaboration in Super Kamiokande between Japan and the United States. And this photo was taken at our institute, Institute for Cosmic Ray Research, in 1992. And we had discussed the responsibilities of the Japanese and the US side. And well, I think the meeting went well, because we can see several beer bottles. Anyway, yeah, we agreed. So we started the construction of the Kamiokande, the Super Kamiokande experiment. And this photo was taken in the spring of 95. And you can see a lot of people in the Super Kamiokande tank. And well, in fact, every day, in 95, we had these numbers of people in order to construct the Super Kamiokande detector. And well, at the center, there is Yoji Totsuka, who was the spokesperson of this experiment at the initial stage. Well, okay, this is the spring version. And in fact, well, of course, in the summer, people have more, say, time. Therefore, we have more people in the summer. This is the summer version. So these people worked in the super kamiokande detector. In fact, in the summer, we scheduled to finish one tower every day. And one tower contained 204 inner detector photomultiplier tubes and 34 outer detector photomultiplier tubes. So every day we constructed one tower. Anyway, I think the construction went extremely well, and we started the water filling in January 96. And this photo was taken in January 1996, and a photo was taken from the top of the tank to the bottom. Okay, I think this page is too technical, so I skip. Okay, from the beginning of the experiment, we observed regularly atmospheric neutrino interactions. The left two events are relatively low energy atmospheric neutrino interactions. You can see one Cherenkov ring for each event. But if the energy is getting higher, then we begin to observe another category of events. For example, the right bottom one has a particular topology. These events were neutrino interactions where, the neutrino interaction occurred in the rock below the detector, and only a muon produced by this interaction is observed, and the muon come into the detector from the bottom and exited to the top. So we observe all these kinds of events in super kamiokande. And also, I believe you notice that the event patterns are very different. Therefore, it was very important that super kamiokande collaboration work coherently to analyze these data. So we really needed a lot of manpower to analyze all these types of events. But I have to thank the young collaborators at that time for their extremely hard work. And in fact, in 2 years, we were able to announce the important results from this experiment. And we reported the result at the Neutrino Conference in 1998. And this is the slide, I believe. This is the most important slide we showed in this meeting. Here, we show the Zenith angle distribution for electrons and muons. And please see the Zenith angle distribution for muons. Oh, by the way, again, cosine theta 1 means downgoing neutrinos, and cosine theta minus 1 means upward-going neutrinos. And you can see there is a huge deficit of upward-going muon neutrino events, while the downgoing muon neutrinos show no such deficit. So clearly, you can see only neutrinos coming from the other side show deficit. And this is what we expected by neutrino oscillations. And therefore, we carried out the neutrino oscillation studies with various data samples, and the data essentially suggested the neutrino oscillation with essentially the consistent and unique oscillation parameter, that is neutrino mass and the mixing parameter regions. So from this, Super Kamiokande concluded that the observed Zenith angle dependence and the other supporting data gave evidence for neutrino oscillations. And I think we were lucky because at that time, there were other atmospheric neutrino experiments that can test the results from Super Kamiokande. And these two experiments, Macro and Sudan 2, also observed Zenith angle dependent deficit of muon neutrinos and confirmed neutrino oscillations. Okay, that was the discovery. And well, because of the importance of the neutrino oscillations or neutrino mass, various accelerator-based long baseline neutrino oscillation experiments have been studying oscillations in detail. This is the list of neutrino oscillation experiments. Now, I want to move on to the oscillation studies with atmospheric neutrinos. Well, first of all, Super Kamiokande is still taking data. So I want to compare the number of events observed in Super Kamiokande and also Kamiokande. And also I want to compare the number of events in 98 and this year. So, well, compared with 98 data, our data statistics has been improved by more than a factor of 10. And therefore, we are carrying out various detailed studies of neutrino oscillations. And I can tell you just two examples. Well, of course, it was very nice to see the atmospheric, to see that approximately half of the long-traveling muon neutrinos disappear. However, we wanted to really confirm neutrino oscillations. That means, we expected this kind of oscillatory behavior in neutrino oscillation, neutrino survival probability. But unfortunately, the Zenith angle distribution shown at the left top doesn't show this kind of behavior. So we really wanted to observe the dip, oscillation dip, and therefore we carried out a special analysis, and we saw the first oscillation dip in 2004. So with this, we really confirmed neutrinos oscillate. In addition, if the oscillation is between muon neutrino and tau neutrinos, we should observe the appearance of tau neutrinos. So far, all we discussed was the measurement of the muon neutrino deficit. But if the oscillation is between muon neutrino and tau neutrinos, then we should observe the appearance of tau neutrinos. However, this is not easy. Shown in the left is a typical tau neutrino event to be observed in Super Kamiokande. This is a simulation event. So by observing this kind of complicated event pattern, you have to tell if the event is tau neutrino or not. Well, it took us many years to get the convincing result. But with the recent improvement in the software analysis tools, we were finally able to confirm some signal of appearance of tau neutrinos. And well, maybe it may not be so convincing to you, but the red part is the appearance of the tau neutrinos, and statistically this is really significant already. Now, I want to briefly discuss the future neutrino oscillation experiments. Well, today I concentrate on atmospheric neutrino experiment. However, there are various other types of neutrino oscillation experiments. And by now, we already understand the basic structure for three-flavor neutrino oscillations. So, well, in a sense, we are very happy to come to this stage. However, unfortunately, fortunately, there are still many important measurements to be done. This is maybe a partial list. Well, we do not know the neutrino mass pattern, and also we do not know if the neutrino oscillation probability is same for neutrinos and antineutrinos, and we do not know if the neutrino is a special particle, we say Majorana particle. I'm sorry, I do not go into detail of the Majorana particle, what is meant by Majorana particle. In addition, I have to say, actually, we do not know the absolute neutrino mass, and finally, we do not know if there is any structure beyond the three-flavor framework. So this is these are the agenda items for the future neutrino oscillation experiments. And among them, I'm going to briefly discuss the future possibilities in two topics. One is the neutrino mass pattern, and another is the CP variation, that is neutrino and anti-neutrino oscillation difference. Now, about the neutrino mass pattern determination. Well, I can say that there are various next generation experiments trying to observe neutrino mass pattern. And also, there are plans trying to measure the difference between neutrino oscillations and anti-neutrino oscillations. However, well, in particular, these experiments are extremely difficult experiments. And it's clear that the present day experiments are not powerful enough. Therefore, we believe we definitely need the next generation experiments with much better performance and probably much larger mass. And there are actually two projects. One is in United States and one is in Japan. Okay, well, basically, that's all what I wanted to say. But before summarizing, I want to show you one more slide. This is the map of the experiments carried out in Kamioka now. And I want to mention that, well, about 30 years ago, there were only one experiment, Kamiokande. But now, as you can see, there are various other experiments going on. And in particular, I want to mention that we are now constructing a large-scale gravitational wave interferometer in underground Kamioka. This experiment is called Kagura, and we would like to start the operation probably 2019. So, well, in addition to neutrino physics, we are trying to observe gravitational waves as well. Okay, let me summarize. Proton decay experiments in the 80s observed many contained atmospheric neutrino events and discovered the atmospheric neutrino deficit. And 10 years later, 1998, Super Kamiokande discovered neutrino oscillations, which shows that neutrinos have mass. Well, personally, I feel that I have been extremely lucky because I have been involved in the excitement of this discovery from the beginning. And well, since the discovery of oscillations, various experiments, including soil neutrino experiments, have studied neutrino oscillations. And well, I'm sorry, I didn't discuss this part. And the discovery of non-zero neutrino masses opened a window to study physics beyond the standard model of particle physics. And there are still many important measurements or discoveries to be done in neutrinos. So I think we still have to work hard. Okay, that's all. Uh-huh, I see. Okay, Maybe I may answer this way. If neutrino has no mass, then neutrinos has to travel with the speed of light. Then in this case, the neutrino clock doesn't proceed. Say 12 o'clock is always 12 o'clock. Then, since no time change, the state cannot be changed because there's no time. If neutrino change their type, that means the state has changed. That means neutrinos travel with the speed less than the speed of the light. And this means neutrinos have mass. I see. Well, okay. I think it's important to have the collaboration between academia and industries. And in fact, well, I think Japanese universities are moving on to this direction. However, as far as our institute is concerned, we are the most far institute from this collaboration between us and the industries. But anyway, there are various researches going on in Japanese universities. Therefore, in the future, we should have more closer collaboration.
I should point out that some of the things you saw in the early Kamiokande picture, the round thing you saw, that's something that was made by Hamamatsu.
Yeah.
If
Koshiba-san didn't have this close connection with those companies. Yeah. That
Yes, that's true. Thank you.
Over there.
Do you feel that there are aspects of the scientific environment in Japan that made this discovery possible that would not have been possible in another country?
Oh. My short answer is no. This could happen any country. Okay, but in a sense, there is some difference. As I said, Super Kamiokande has been in operation already for 20 years. This kind of long operation for a single project may not happen in some other countries. Society. In fact, the reason I showed this slide was because I wanted to tell you what I'm involved now. I said, well, we are now constructing the gravitational wave interferometer, and I'm involved in this project now. So we would like to observe gravitational wave in this detector as observed in LIGO. And we would like to construct the worldwide network of the gravitational interferometers in order to do the astronomy with these gravitational waves. That is my next step. Okay, we have some common target. For example, if a supernova happened in our galaxy, then Super Kamiokande may observe, for example, 10,000 neutrino events in 10 seconds. And at the same time, we will observe gravitational waves. And by combining these two information, we get the very detailed information on the supernova, what is happening at the core of the supernova explosion. And about the second question.
Now let's turn to the hard question.
Well, about the relation to the society. Well, I think we are providing, knowledge to the whole human being. So far, we didn't know neutrinos have mass, but now we are telling you that neutrinos have mass. This is our task, I believe. Well, okay. Of course, I don't know, but what I feel is, in order to get the important scientific result, there must be some history in some scientific field. So I think Japan was kind of lucky. Our system was completely destroyed by the World War II, but after the World War II, Japan tried to recover very quickly, and therefore the university system recover, or even get stronger. Therefore, we had, say, almost 70 years of the history. And I believe now Korea and also China is spending really substantial amount of the budget for the scientific researches. Therefore, in my opinion, it will not be far from now that the Korean scientists get the Nobel Prize. Okay, yes, the confirmation of the Majorana nature is extremely important. Well, we believe that extremely small masses are extremely important because, and we have the model to explain this extremely small neutrino masses, but this relies on the assumption that neutrinos are Majorana particles. If they are Dirac particles, I think we have no idea why the neutrino masses are so small. And also, neutrino masses might be related to the baryon asymmetry in the universe. And again, this relies on the assumption of Majorana nature. I see. Well, okay. I'm a quite optimistic person, and I forget everything unwanted. So, anyway, I had a very bad moment in 2001. Our super Kamiokande detector was destroyed badly. We lost more than 6,000 photometers per year tubes in less than 1 minute. And this was the worst moment to me. And but we were able to recover. And if I recall, what was important for the recovery was, I think the first was the very strong leadership. Well, the leader at that moment was Professor Totsuka, I showed. And he, soon after this accident, he interviewed many collaboration members, and he understood that all of us wanted to recover from the accident. And therefore, he announced to the whole community, to the world, that Super Kamiokande is going to be rebuilt without asking anything to the funding agency. That was actually important. So, this kind of strong, very important leadership was very important for the recovery, and also because of that, the collaboration worked coherently toward their recovery. So I think in the future physicist, scientist, I think one important message is in many of these cases, we work as a team. Therefore, teamwork is very important in my opinion.
Speaking of young scientists, I would like to ask one question, which is, how was it like being a graduate student in 1985 building that thing? far away from civilization.
Yeah.
How enjoyable was it?
Okay, well, actually, this is my personality, but I liked the life in Kamioka. Yes. Well, unfortunate thing was, that was before the internet. Therefore, if we come to Kamioka, we were completely separated from the other people. Therefore, if you want, you can study as much as you want. Or if you want, you can drink as much as you like.
We're not encouraging you guys on that.
Yes. That is, advanced question. Yes, muon and electron are extremely similar particles, but muon is 200 times heavier than electron. Therefore, if they propagate with the same initial kinetic energy, the speed is different. And electron is extremely ultra-relativistic. And therefore, they can, in fact, interact with the material emitting photons. And these photons, again, interact with the material, producing electron and positron pair. This kind of complicated process we call electromagnetic shower is produced, but muon, on the other hand, just propagates straightly. So the Cherenkov photons from the muon is produced by this single muon, but on the other hand, electrons, since they produce electromagnetic shower, many particles, these many particles emit Cherenkov photons. Therefore, and each particle's direction is slightly different. Therefore, the Cherenkov ring pattern is a little bit more obscured.
Okay, with this very much scientific note, let's